Hi, Westside. It's the Hildebrands here. We'll be reading from John chapter 2, verses 1 to 11 today. If you're able to stand for the reading of the Word of God, please do so now.
On the third day, there was a wedding at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus also was invited to the wedding with his disciples. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine."
And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." And his mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now, there were 6 stone water jars there for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the feast." So they took it.
When the master of the feast tasted the water, now become wine, and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and when the people have drunk freely, then the poor wine. But you have kept the good wine until now."
This, the first of his signs, Jesus did at Cana in Galilee, and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
It's great to have you with us here in the room, as at home as well, as Tiff said. We're excited about the home gatherings that are happening these days as well. We're going to give some more help and support to those of you gathering at home in the coming weeks, so stay tuned for that. We're really excited about all the Lord's doing. We know there's people getting together in the morning. They have breakfast beforehand and then watch a live stream together. It's just amazing things that the Lord's doing as far as we love each other, make disciples and all that, and so just beautiful stuff happening. But those of you who are here with us as well, so good to have you. It's very good to see some faces, and I'm excited about this morning. By the way, happy Thanksgiving. We have a lot as Christians to be thankful for. Even right now, even in the middle of a pandemic, we have a ton to be thankful for. We'll see a lot of what that is today, but I'm excited to have you in the room with us today also, and I just believe that the Lord has some things he wants to say to us, do in us, and our posture really this morning, as it is, you know, every time that we gather and worship together, gather to sit under the word, is really just to receive. We just need to receive from him. You are here to receive. You don't have anything to give to him. He has things he wants to give to you. And so, you know, John 15 tells that Jesus is the vine and that we are the branches. And as the branches, we can't actually, you know, stir up any life. We you know, the fruit that comes out of the branches, the fruit and the healthy leaves, these don't come from the branches. They come from the source. They come from the root. And so our posture as Jesus people, and if you're not in Jesus yet, or you wouldn't self-identify as a Christian, welcome here. We're glad to have you as well and walk with you. But our posture as Jesus people is just to receive. And so I want to invite you into that today through prayer, and then we'll walk through this amazing text, this first sign in the Gospel of John at the wedding of Cana. So Lord, we thank you so much that we'd get to just come and receive from you. And Lord, we thank you that it's your joy. It is your joy. It's your delight, Lord, to pour into us, to give us your Holy Spirit. We thank you that you are a good Father. We thank you that you've not left any of us as orphans, that we are yours. And so, Lord, today we just ask that we would know you as Father. We would know you as the good Father, the good Shepherd, the one who has laid down his life for his sheep, and the one who's came and lived and died and rose so that we could actually be transformed, not just live the same old ways anymore, but actually live transformed lives. And we know, Lord, these transformed lives begin every day with this posture of just receiving. And so, Lord, would you please fill us as we open our hands to receive from you this morning through your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So 10 weeks ago, we started this series. We paused in 1 Corinthians for a bit and started this series in the Gospel of John because, you know, I just felt, you know, strongly we're in the midst of a lot of chaos. Everything's changing around us. All these things are happening. You know, we've got a pandemic. There's all these social and economic and political tensions, and, you know, lives are flipped upside down. And so it just became, you know, very obvious that there's one thing we need right now. There's one thing that we have to focus on. That's just Jesus. We just need to see Jesus. Now, this call to behold him, it's the only command we've been given so far in the Gospel of John. He just says, behold. It's the command to just look, to see him as he is. This call is not a call to escape, you know, or distract ourselves from the other areas of life. You know, we have work and school and family, and we have all these, you know, social, economic, political tensions. I mean, there's all these things unfolding around us right now. Things are just kind of crazy out there. But this command to look is not a command, a call to escape. It's an invitation for Jesus to actually fill every area of your life, like the whole thing. You have one compartment in life. You have one life, and Jesus wants to consume it. He wants to permeate it. He wants to fill you. And so this filling, as we've talked about this, you know, we're the branches, he's the vine. This reception begins, step one in the Christian life. Like, however long you've been a Christian, however many decades you've known Jesus, or whether you're just coming to know him today, either way, step one in receiving his life is just looking at him. Just looking at him. He's not actually asking us for a lot, like he's not actually asking us for so much, just to look at him, just to take all our other thoughts captive and to think about him, just to meditate on him. And so that's what we're doing. That's what John is walking us through. He wrote to answer the question that we want the whole world to ask, who is this Jesus? As our lives are transformed, more and more people will be asking this question. And so far we've seen Jesus is the divine word. He's the logos. He's the grand unifying principle. He's the one from whom, to whom, and for whom are all things. Jesus is life itself, Zoe life, the life that is the light of humankind. We've beheld him together already in his glory, full of grace and truth. We've seen that he's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He's the one who baptizes us with the Holy Spirit. He's the Messiah. And this week, we're going to see another title. When we come to today's text, we're going to see that he's also the bridegroom, which is an old-fashioned biblical way of saying groom, but carries a little bit more weight. I like it a lot more. He's the bridegroom. So the text in front of us today centers around a miracle. The text that the Hildebrands read for us, it centers around a miracle, or as John calls it in verse 11, a sign. We're going to get to that in a minute, but off the top, you need to understand this about the Christian faith. The Christian faith begins with a supernatural God who loves to work in his creation. It's his delight to work in his creation. It begins with a supernatural God who delights to work in his creation. I love how one theologian writes that miracles are the innovation of God triumphing over the boredom of mere principle. Now, a purely naturalistic view of the universe has no room for miracles. Like, a purely naturalistic view of the universe has no room whatsoever. But most people today are not even willing to call themselves pure naturalists. There's just too much going on that doesn't fit that framework. The naturalism can't explain, like, for example, personality, higher dimensions, artistic inclination, intrinsic self-worth, consciousness, spirituality, the desire for self-expression. Like, if you believe in any of those things, naturalism doesn't help you. And the Bible's claim is that the reason that we seem to have eternity written on our hearts is because we do. Like, the reason that you are hungry for more, the reason that you are not satisfied, even when you have all the good things in life, all the good things that the world tells you you should have and that will make you happy, and yet you're not, is because you were made for more. The reason human beings have always, rightly or wrongly, worshipped other beings beyond them through every culture is because there is actually one. There is actually one being beyond us worthy of worship, a supernatural God who loves to work in his creation and doesn't confine himself to the realm of the theoretical. It's why C.S. Lewis put it, referring to miracles, says he, meaning God, interferes with nature by supernatural power. That's what we're interested in today. And even still, he does this today. Interferes with nature by supernatural power. But listen, John wasn't just interested in telling us about mere miracles. He wasn't just recording mere miracles for us, Westside. No, he was actually interested in signs. In the book of John, we're going to be given seven signs. This is the first one. As we go through the whole gospel, we're going to see seven signs that reveal to us who Jesus is. The reason they're called signs is because these miracles, these works of power, are meant to expose, help us to behold Jesus as he is. They tell us who he is, what he came to do, what he's like. They're pictures, they're living parables. that reveal Jesus to us. And today we have the first of the seven, the sign, the miracle of water being turned to wine at this wedding in Cana. So four things that we're going to see as we pull back the layers of this sign. We're going to see the bridegroom, the bride price, the bride's joy, and lastly, how we can become the bride. Okay, that's where we're going. So let's jump into it. So Jesus and his disciples are invited to a wedding, and especially in the first century, man, the unthinkable happens. Like, you may have, you know, closed down a bar or two in your days. I wouldn't know anything about that. But in the first century, this is unthinkable. They are running out of wine. They have run out of wine in a first century wedding. And this is a big, big problem. Like, these weddings were meant to stretch on for days, sometimes up to a week. To run out of wine halfway through and for the whole thing to come to a screeching halt because the bride and groom couldn't get their act together and they didn't have enough wine. This was a massive social embarrassment, and that may be why Mary approaches Jesus in verse 3 and goes to him and says, "They have no wine." Okay, so that's the setup. Jesus' response to his mom, Jesus' response to Mary is everything in this text. If there is a key to understanding this sign, it's Jesus' words in verse 4. Listen to what he says. It's really important. In verse 4, Jesus says to his mom, "Woman." Now, I would get slapped for saying something like that. Jesus can get away with it. He says, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." Some translations, they want to work with this a little bit, defend Jesus a little bit. They're a little bit afraid. He seems too rude. So they insert "dear," like as in "dear woman" in the text. It's not in the Greek. In the Greek, this is as rude as it sounds. "Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." Now, Jesus is not just being rude. Jesus actually had perfect control over his emotions and his attitudes. When Mary approaches Jesus about the wine, he is preoccupied. But with what? Look, it's easy to read this, and maybe most people do read this and think that what Jesus is saying here is, "Woman, what does that have to do with me? It's not time for my first miracle yet." Like, most of us read it that way, but that's not what Jesus said. No, he said, "What does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." And that's really important, church. This really matters because throughout John's whole gospel, the Jesus' hour has a very specific meaning. In chapter 7, verse 30, 8, verse 20, 12, verse 23, and 13, verse 1, Jesus' hour refers directly to the hour of his death. Jesus didn't say, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? It's not time for my first miracle yet." No, he said, "Woman, what does this have to do with me? It's not my time to die yet." It's the key to understanding everything else that we're going to see here. So here's the big question. Why does Jesus connect a lack of wine at this wedding with his own death? Why? Why do he and Mary seem to be missing each other so badly here? I mean, what the heck is Jesus talking about? Here's what we know. Throughout the Bible, the life that God wants to give us is often described as a massive feast, a banquet. Like, the life that God wants to give us is often described as a massive feast. And here's the thing about the feast. It always includes a whole bunch of wine, like a lot of wine. For example, in Isaiah 25, 6, where the prophet records, "The Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food." For all peoples, a feast. A feast of well-aged wine, the rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well-refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. This is good news. This is really good news. Thank you for the clapper in the room. The single clapper. It's okay. You know, you guys, it's tough. I know, it's hard. And then as we come to the New Testament, we see the Old Testament, all these allusions to this feast, the life that God gives as a feast. Then we come to the New Testament and the theme of wine and life in Jesus picked up as wine and feast is picked up over and over again before it finally culminates in Revelation 19, where we're told exactly what kind of a feast is being prepared for us. Revelation 19:7, let us rejoice and exalt and give him, meaning Jesus, the glory, the Father, the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb, the marriage supper of the Lamb. Do you see what this means? Jesus connects the fact that this adolescent couple runs out of wine at their own wedding with his death because Jesus is preoccupied thinking about his own wedding. Jesus is doing the one thing that every wedding is meant to help us do. Every wedding is meant to point us, every wedding ceremony is meant to point us to the wedding to end all weddings. And so Jesus is there at the wedding in Cana physically, but thinking about his wedding. When Mary comes to him and says, Jesus, they have no wine, the reason he seems so triggered is because Jesus is calculating the cost, what it's going to cost him to provide wine for his own wedding. To provide wine for his own wedding, Jesus will have to move through that hour. The hour of his death. Woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour has not yet come. It's not my time to die yet. Jesus was thinking about the fact that the point of all human history in the entire cosmos, even the year 2020 and a pandemic and some brutal political debates, if you've been watching, oh my goodness, and all the tension and all the unknowns is all leading us toward one thing. All of it toward one thing. Just one thing. The wedding to literally end all other weddings. Jesus' wedding. The day when the people of God will finally be joined to Jesus fully and completely forever. In other words, to grab what's here in this first sign, we have to start by seeing Jesus as he is, not just the divine word, the light of men, the Lamb of God, the one who baptizes in the Holy Spirit or Messiah, but also bridegroom. Bridegroom. Jesus as the bridegroom is important in all the gospel accounts, especially in John. That's why, you know, in John chapter 3, we'll get there in a couple of weeks, when John the Baptist's followers begin leaving him to follow Jesus. John the Baptist says this in John 3:29, the one who has the bride is the bridegroom. The friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly at the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, John says, this joy of mine is now complete. He must increase, but I must decrease. John could say that and do that because Jesus is the bridegroom. It's why when Jesus was confronted by the religious leaders about the fact that his disciples and him seemed to party so much and fast so little, Jesus responded in Luke 5:34 by saying, can you make wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? And it's why on the night when Jesus' hour had finally come, he told his disciples he was going to prepare a place for them. And then in John 14:3 said, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. You have to know, Jesus ripped this right out of an ancient wedding liturgy. This is straight out of an engagement ceremony from the first century. I mean, this is one of the most audacious claims that Jesus ever made. To be the bridegroom is one of the most audacious claims he could ever make. Why? Because in the Old Testament, only God the Father spoke this way. For example, in Isaiah 54, where the Lord said, fear not, for you will not be ashamed. You will not be disgraced. Why? For your maker is your husband. For your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. This is why when Mary seemed to, when she told Jesus they had run out of wine, she triggered him so hard because Jesus is the bridegroom and Jesus knew that moving through his hour was the only way to provide wine for his wedding. The wine that had run out a long, long time ago, way back to the garden. And for anyone here who thinks an open bar at your wedding's expensive, I have news for you. We need to move to the second point, from the bridegroom to the bride price. Now, I know that we tend to look down today on purchasing brides, okay? For good reason. We tend to look down today on purchasing brides, but that's not how it was in much of the ancient world. And in the New Testament, it's very clear that Jesus purchases the church. And the bride price he paid is numbing, mind-numbing. So Mary comes to Jesus. Jesus responds to Mary. Mary ignores his attitude and tells some servants to do whatever he tells them. And in verse 6 and 7, we're told that Jesus had the servants fill 6 stone jars, the jars that were reserved for ceremonial washing. That detail really matters. Like, these details in John's gospel, especially in this sign, really matter. These 6 jars were set aside for the purpose of cleansing. Cleansing people before they entered the temple. Cleansing people before they entered, walked into the presence of God. And everyone knew the water itself didn't actually clean them. Everyone knew it was symbolic, but symbolic of what? It was symbolic of the fact that we are stained by sin, and we do need to be totally cleansed to come into the presence of the living God. Jesus, they have no more wine. Woman, what does it have to do with me? My hour to die has not yet come. And then he sees it. He sees it. The living parable all around him. He sees that this wedding, this moment of potential social embarrassment will be the place of his first sign. The first picture his disciples and a few servants would get of who he is and what he came to do. The first revelation of how mind-numbingly expensive the bride price would be. In ancient Egypt, when God used Moses to set his people free from slavery there, one of the things that he did was turn the water of the Nile River to blood. Water to blood. Sign of the curse. Jesus is about to turn water to wine, which is a sign of the reversal of that curse. Water to blood under the law, the curse that the law exposes to us, and now water to wine in this new covenant of grace, this covenant of grace that the Lord is picking up from way back. But to reverse the curse, to be the bridegroom, to pay the bride price and give his bride the cup of blessing to drink, Jesus would have to drink his own cup first. To give us the cup of his blessing, Jesus would have to drink the cup of our curse, like down to its dregs, like all of it. It's why when his hour had finally come, we read this in Matthew 26, 39, Jesus fell on his face and prayed, saying, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." Jesus, they have no more wine. Woman, what does that have to do with me? My hour to drink the curse and die has not yet come. But why, church, friends, why would anybody pay that kind of a bride price, especially the living God, I mean, who doesn't even need us? Why would he do this? Why would he go to those lengths and put himself through that kind of agony? I'll tell you why he does it. He does it because the bridegroom doesn't just want a bride. He wants the bride to experience real, objective, transformational, unshakable, irrevocable joy. Joy. I mean, do you hear this word? Joy. He wants his bride to not just become his bride, but to experience unshakable, real, transformational, irrevocable joy. And joy can only come when the curse and everything tainted by it is swallowed up and thrown into the depths of hell. So bridegroom, bride price, bride's joy. I just want you to see one thing here in this picture, this wedding at Cana, at the very center of everything Jesus, the bridegroom, wants for you, for his bride, is joy. I mean, the reason the Bible pictures life in God's presence as a feast with truckloads of wine. Truckloads of wine. Like, you cannot run out of the wine at his feast. The reason it's pictured that way is because in his presence there is fullness of joy. At his right hand are pleasures forevermore. I mean, are you experiencing these things? Church, fullness of joy, pleasures forevermore at his right hand. This is what the Bible says God has for us. This is what the Bible says is real. I mean, that's why the first sign is at a wedding in the first place. That's why Jesus' disciples couldn't fast while he was with them. That's why Jesus didn't make just enough wine to get them through the feast. No, Jesus in this parable, in this sign, made 120 to 180 gallons of wine. That's a lot of wine. That's like 1,000 bottles of wine. I mean, that'll get you through a wedding, especially a small wedding in Cana. That's a whole lot of wine, the best wine the master of the feast had ever tasted. But why so much wine? And why such good wine? Why so much wine? And why such good wine? I mean, didn't Jesus know how uncomfortable this would make some of us religious types? Didn't he know how uncomfortable that would make us? Didn't he know the debates that would start among, you know, well, I don't know how high the alcohol percentage of this wine really would stop with that. Like, do yourself a favor and do not try to round the edges on this. I mean, if you want to say the wine was only 4 or 5%, fine. Jesus made 1,000 bottles of beer. Okay, is that better? Does that make you more comfortable? That's fine. Whatever you need to do to get through it. But please understand the reason why Jesus makes so much, even though it would make some people, some of his followers so uncomfortable, is because he doesn't care it makes you uncomfortable. All through the Bible, wine is a sign of God's blessing and favor, and the living God isn't concerned. He isn't in the habit of holding his blessings and favors back. He wants to pour them out. He wants to pour them out on you. Overflowing vats of wine symbolize the blessing of God's kingdom and his presence, and he wants us to know these blessings are fully realized in Jesus. Jesus is not scared of you abusing his blessings. He wants you to gorge yourself on them. Like, he wants you to gorge yourself on them. He wants you to see him, to receive him. He wants to fill you. He wants to baptize you over and over and over again with his Holy Spirit. He wants you to gorge yourself on his blessings. He wants you drowning yourselves in them. He wants to drench you in his life. Don't forget, this is the one who came, as we read already, to constantly baptize us, immerse us, drench us in his Spirit. And look, I get that not all of us really easily resonate with the picture of Jesus as a bridegroom and us as a bride. I get that's not really natural for a lot of us. I mean, some of us just love the picture. It's like the best picture we could ever imagine. For others of us, it's like really uncomfortable. But don't miss the point of what's being communicated to us. Don't miss the point of what we're seeing here. The point is he's after your joy. The point is your total assurance. Jesus is the king. Jesus is the king and we're his subjects. Jesus is the shepherd and we're his sheep. Those are important pictures. But look, Jesus as a king doesn't have to like his subjects. A shepherd can merely put up with his sheep. But Jesus as the bridegroom means that we aren't just accepted by him, put up with by him. We're desired. We're desired. Like, look, I'm just going to say this gently and calmly, and those who have ears, I just hope you hear it. You're desired by him. You're loved. Like a groom loves a bride. As a pastor, I get to spend a lot of time standing in places like this with a groom right here as a bride walks down the aisle. That moment is the best moment of the whole wedding. Most people only get to see it a few times. You're only a groom, you know, a few times, hopefully. And, you know, I get to see it, you know, pastors, ministers get to see it a whole lot. It's the best moment. The bride is desired, longed for, not just accepted, loved. This is the point. The wedding day is in drudgery for Jesus, his joy, and it's meant to be ours too. And until you taste this joy, you will not be able to comprehend why Jesus paid the bride price that he did. Why he drank the curse so you could drink the blessing. Like, until you taste this joy, you will not be able to comprehend. It won't make sense what David wrote in Psalm 34. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Like, everyone in ancient Israel already knew theoretically, already knew that the Lord was good. That was a concept. It was very, firmly entrenched in the people. They had to believe it. David didn't care if they believed it. He wanted them to taste it. Taste it. It's why Jonathan Edwards wrote this. He said, there's a difference between believing that God is holy and gracious and having this new sense on the heart of the loveliness and beauty of that holiness and grace. The difference between believing that God is gracious and tasting that God is gracious is as different as having a rational belief that honey is sweet and having the actual experience of his sweetness. I want you to know something. This is Thanksgiving, and hopefully you have a meal or two coming up this weekend. The good food that you taste, let me just encourage you. You don't have to buy the wine off the bottom shelf of BCL. For this weekend, you can jump up a shelf or two and buy the better wine as you taste it. As you taste that food, that rich food, as you taste the feast, will you do me a favor and just remember Jesus? This is the way he wants you to taste how good he is and the joy of his salvation. Jesus didn't pay the bride price so you could be invited to sign off on a certain set of theological principles or doctrines or beliefs. No, Jesus paid it so you could be invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Jesus went through that hour and drank our curse because he wanted to make sure you could experience the joy of being joined to him. That is, if you want to become the bride. Bridegroom, bride price, bride's joy. Let me close it here with become the bride. Now, I have good news today for anyone who's hungry for joy. I've got really good. We started this off by saying our job today and every day, and especially when we gather together, is just to put ourselves in a posture of receiving from him. We're just here to receive from him. That's good news. And the better news is that as you open your hands to receive from him, he will actually fill you up if you want him to. And there are actually some things you can do to ensure that he fills you up. There are actually some things you can do. I want to give you 4 steps. Now, this doesn't matter. This doesn't matter if you know Jesus already or not yet. If you want to step into constant communion with him, there are 4 steps to becoming the bride that we can pull out of this text. I'll rattle them off pretty quick, and then we're going to respond together. Okay, here's step number 1. First, you have to go to him, and you have to tell him, I'm out. The wine has run out of my life. Jesus, I have no more wine. The joy is gone. There's nothing that I can do to give life to myself. This is what Mary went and said to Jesus, and it's always the first step. Before Jesus works his power in our life, before Jesus meets us, we have to come to him and say, I need you to meet with me. We have to just put ourselves in that place and say, and so look, if you've never come to Jesus before, this is where it all begins. This is where your life changes. You come to him and say, I'm out. That I know I'm a sinner. I know I need cleansing. I can't do it myself. I can't get to you myself. And after you come to Jesus, it's the very same thing all over again. You just keep doing this every single day. Jesus, I'm out. It's the first step to him going to work in our lives. We have no wine without him. His blessings can't be earned or manipulated by us. We can't twist his arm. We are out. The cellar is empty. There is no wine at all. This is step 1. And listen, if he's emptying you these days, if you are being emptied out these days, if you're struggling in these days, if you are coming to the end of yourself in these days, that is good news. This is where he's trying to take you. I promise you, if he's emptying you out, this is where he's trying to take you, to the point where you can go to him and say, I'm out. I can't look to myself in this. Step 1, go to him and tell him you're out. Step 2, Wait on him. He makes the next move. Mary didn't know what Jesus would do. She only knew that Jesus would do something. She didn't know what he would do. She only knew that he would do something. She just believed that he would do something. She had belief in his power. She had seen enough. So she told the servants to wait on him. Okay, here's step one and two together. Tell him you're out and wait on him for his response. Tell him you're out and wait on him for it. The greatest need in the church today is for every one of us to remember who we are in relationship to him. He's the vine. We are the branches. All we can do is receive. But for the branch to receive from the vine, you have to stop trying to rip yourself off the vine and go make it happen yourself. I was meditating on that last night, and that wasn't actually written in my sermon. And then this morning, in my time with him early, I just happened to be in Ezekiel 47, where we have the river pouring out of the temple of God, like the river of life pouring from the temple of God. And then it tells that there are all these trees, you know, on the bank of the river bearing fruit, and their leaves are for the healing of the nation. A branch can do nothing unless it's abiding in the vine. All its life, all its fruit comes from abiding in the vine, so too a tree planted by a river. Like in Psalm 1. Christian, this is who you are. But you have to stop trying to bear the fruit yourself. You go to him, you tell him you're out, you wait on him. Step three is you take all the credit. Jesus turned water to wine, and when the master of the feast tasted it, he gave all the credit to the disorganized bride and groom. He thought they'd saved the best wine till last, but they'd actually had nothing to do with it. If it was up to them, they'd be put to shame. They would be embarrassed, but they weren't left alone. They got all the credit, and Jesus invites you to do the very same thing. He invites you to go to the Father and say, "Thank you for Jesus. Now give me all the credit for his life." He invites you to go to Jesus and say, "When you look at me, I want you to see him." I mean, it's scandalous, church, but this is the gospel. The living God wants us to get shockingly bold when it comes to leaning on him for his goodness and grace. And finally, fourth, so we go to him, tell him we're out, we wait on him, we take all the credit. And finally, fourth, last step, we start tasting the wine for ourselves. It's time to start tasting the joy of the Lord. It's time to start being strengthened by his joy. In ancient Israel, marriage began when the couple was engaged. That's when you were married. So even after you got engaged, if you wanted to be divorced, or if you were going to be separate after that, it was a divorce. What they would do is they would have a betrothal ceremony. At this betrothal ceremony, the groom would after that ceremony, he would leave to get the house prepared, and then he would come back much later to receive his bride. This is the way that marriage worked in the first century, and this is what Jesus is doing right now. But at the engagement ceremony, before the groom left, they would share a cup of wine. They would share a cup of wine, and they would exchange their vows. This is the covenant that Jesus made on the night when his hour had finally come. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." We celebrate that Jesus went through his hour to provide wine for his wedding. We celebrate that Jesus drank the cup of our curse so that we could drink the cup of his blessing. Westside, when we come together as his church, the bride, even gathered virtually, like Jesus is delighted in you and he's delighted in us being together, virtually here in the room, in your home with others. And as we come together as his bride, he invites us to renew our vows, to remember the covenant that he made, to remember that the one we've been engaged to said, "Okay, I'm leaving for a little bit, but I'm going to come back and receive you to myself. I go to prepare a place for you. I'm going to come back and receive you to myself." tasting the wine and the bread is the renewal of the covenant, the renewal of our vow. So here's the invitation. Jesus is inviting you today to get engaged to him for the first time. To be engaged to him for the first time, or to renew your vows with him. As John writes, this is the manifestation of his glory in verse 11, full of grace and truth. So for the first time today, or maybe for the first time ever, you're invited to fix your eyes on the bridegroom. To understand and comprehend by his spirit how great the bride price is that he paid for you. Why? Because he wants his bride full of joy. We are meant to be in the city of people of joy, especially in joyless times, and people of hope, especially in hopeless times, and people of life, especially when death seems so obvious and it's all where anyone's talking about these days. Church, do you want to come alive? Like, is there anybody who wants to come alive and wants more and wants to experience, not just to know, but to experience what Jesus said he came so you could experience? I mean, is there anybody sick and tired of just experiencing way too little of the life that Jesus said he came to give? If that's you, then come to him today. Tell him you're out. Wait on him. Take all the credit. Enjoy taking all the credit. He wants you to take all the credit. And then with us at home or here in the room, taste the wine and remember him. Renew the covenant with him today. And if you want to do that for the first time, let us know. We'll walk with you through it. So Jesus, would you now shower us with joy? Would you let the rain fall on your people? Would you calm anxious hearts? Would you still distracted minds? Would you bring peace? Bring peace to hearts that are just full of death, Lord. I ask for those who are hungry, for those who are thirsty, that right now, Lord, you would speak life to them and they would take courage as they hear your voice. Lord, allow us to hear your voice and give us the courage to obey what we hear. And Lord, I ask that courage and that obedience would lead us to be a people who just every day come to you and say, okay, I'm out. You have to do it. A people who thank you for all that Jesus has done. A people who taste, make it a practice of their lives to taste your goodness. So Lord, fill us up. Fill up your church. We love you. We love you. We love you. Bring your joy to our lives in Jesus' name. Amen.